My name is Bob Reese. I'm the general manager of CMC. We are a division of AGI, or Ag Growth International. Firstly, I want to thank everyone in the audience today for taking the time out of your very busy schedules to join me. We're going to talk about a topic that's very near and dear to us here at CMC, and we're very passionate about helping our customers create a culture of safety in their organizations. So in the hour that we have together today, we're going to talk a little bit about safety devices and hazard monitoring best practices. A bit of an overview of what we're going to talk about here. We have limited time, but we're going to touch on the NFPA and OSHA compliance standards for grain handling facilities. We'll spend a bit of time on CMC solutions and our services and typical installations and best practices. We'll segue into a short discussion on CMC's roadmap to HazMon safety. And toward the end, we're going to have a Q&A session. And we've invited a couple of our trusted colleagues to join us at the end. We have a fellow named Mike Spillum. He is the sales and marketing manager for High Roller Conveyors. And we also have Rick McClellan. He is a senior technology specialist for AGI. And both of these fellows have north of 30 years of experience. And with myself, we can say we have 100 years of experience. So hopefully today's presentation will be of value and interest. And we will speak for a few moments at the end to discuss a new tool that AGI is coming out with called the Virtual Showroom. So with that, at CMC, our mission since 1997 has been about protecting human life and property. So all of our products and services that we bring to the industry support this concept. So as I mentioned before, we are attempting to help our customers and also our channel partners to improve safety, reducing risk, and then together elevating performance. Sadly, OSHA reports that over the past 35 years, there have been more than 500 explosions at grain handling facilities across the United States that have killed in excess of 180 people and injuring an additional 675. So this topic comes up rather frequently amongst my colleagues, safety professionals, and operational professionals. And the question we ask is, have we improved as an industry? And in my 30 years in this industry, I could say statistically that we have, but we have a long way to go. I can say I've had the pleasure to meet dozens and dozens of safety professionals that have created safety systems in their organizations, safety systems, installing hazard monitoring systems, and installing zero tolerance for unsafe behavior. So my hat's off to these people. But we collectively do feel we can do better. So the question always comes back to is how. So to not be too simplistic, it really starts with knowledge and education. So these types of conversations we're having today and sharing our collective knowledge with the younger generations coming into the industry and with us senior people, we can always be reminded that acting safe is not just a tagline. Interweaving safety practices into our operations is just good business. So, what is mandated to be compliant for hazard monitoring systems in the grain industry in particular? I would invite all who are present on this call and anyone who serves the grain industry or operates in the grain industry, I highly recommend that you obtain a copy of the NFPA 61 standard for the prevention of fires and dust explosions. In addition, Google the OSHA standard 1910.272. It is imperative that we obtain these copies and know them and understand them. And once you have this information, you will be acting safer. It's a step in the right direction. So this standard is quite extensive and it could take all day to cover. So in the hour that we have, we're gonna talk about a small section of the standard in a section under prevention. So the CMC hazard monitoring products falls under that prevention section. So how to prevent the fires. So with the limited time we have, in this standard, we'll talk about as an example, an inside bucket elevator, okay? A bucket elevator that happens to be in a classified dusty environment. So for the sake of time, we'll narrow our focus on bearing temperature monitoring. So we know that a hot bearing can be a source of ignition. So you have to have two bearings at the head of that bucket elevator and two at the tail. We'll dive into belt misalignment detection technology. You're required to have two at the head and two at the tail. We'll focus a little bit of time on shaft speed sensing. So in the event that your bucket elevator or belt conveyor doesn't have the proper amount of tension, that driven take-up pulley can begin to slip on that belt, and that can create a source of friction, and again, another source of a possible ignition. And then also plug chute detection. So if you have a chute that gets plugged with grain, it can back up into your bucket elevator or conveyor and not only create a mess, but a potential hazard. And then lastly, machinery control is equally important. So meaning you must have the ability to notify plant operations with an audible horn that you have a potential hazard present. And lastly, the ability to shut those machines down again with in the event of a specific hazard. Again, we'll go into more detail in the coming slides. Briefly, knowledge and education, as I mentioned earlier, is a big deal to CMC. And from that, it started years ago. I was fielding dozens of questions from colleagues in the industry asking me, you know, Bob, what do I need to be OSHA compliant or NFPA compliant at my facility? Well, then we took the time at CMC to actually obtain the standards and read them and be a student of the standards and stay on top of the changes that are made over the years. So we started a process called the Roadmap to HazMon Safety. That is, again, rooted in knowledge and education. And the first step in the road to HazMon Safety is providing what we call hazard monitoring assessments. So we will send a factory trained individual to your facility, and we will tour your facility, and we'll catalog all your machines and all the sensors, if you have any, and provide you a report that says you need these types of sensors in these locations to be compliant to these specific standards. So we will talk in a little greater detail in the coming slides about the breadth of what the Roadmap to Safety system means to you. So we like to think of grain elevators as special places. Now, in this context, it means dust, meaning they're dusty locations. We know that grain processing and grain handling facilities can create dust and combustible dust. So it's imperative that we as professionals and you as owners of these facilities understand what the fundamentals of dust hazards are and where they may be in your location. So grain dust has been classified as class 2, group G, divisions 1 and 2. So division 1 simply means that dust is present during operations. Division 2 is an area where dust is intermittently present during operations. This is extremely important to understand and to know and to identify at your facility, because it will dictate what types of hazard monitoring devices you will need, if any. Additionally, we strongly urge that you obtain a copy of the NFPA 652 standard. It will educate you on the fundamentals of combustible dusts and where they may be located. And also, it's imperative that you hire a professional or have a professional on staff that can do a dust hazard analysis. So they will walk your floor and identify the various amounts of dust that is collecting in those areas, and again, classify these divisions as division 1 or division 2. Now, we've been informed that specific types of commercial grain and processing facilities must have these DHAs completed by January 2nd of 2022. Additionally, Electrical components that you select for your grain elevator, whether it's a hazard monitoring system or it could be grain management system, they must be rated and certified by a recognized laboratory. Okay, so these certifications must come from an organization like UL, FM, CSA, or ETL. And this, we advise very strongly that you do not compromise on this rule. It will only potentially lead you to additional unnecessary risk. So now I'd like to segue into the physical portion of the CMC hazard monitoring system and a couple of concepts. This artist rendering before you is a simple, very simplified version of a CMC hazard monitoring system. The CMC hazard monitoring system is a one-wire digital bus network. It is intrinsically safe and it's tested and approved ATEX and ATEX certified. So to be a one-wire bus, one of the benefits as compared to say traditional RTD, thermocouple, thermistor, 4 to 20 milliamp systems that are out there and still being used today, one of the many benefits of this system is instead of having every sensor wired hundreds of meters possibly away from the central plant control, you will save a great deal of unnecessary additional cabling and conduit and labor. In some cases, we can save you up to 50% in saved labor costs at the time of the installation. Additionally, I'd like to introduce you, if you're not familiar, to the term intrinsically safe. So the CMC system is intrinsically safe and tested. And why that is important to you as a grain handler is being intrinsically safe at the root is limiting the energy in the unsafe classified area. So that means we are limiting the electrical current and voltage in the unsafe area. So all of our sensors, our cabling, and our field interconnect boxes are intrinsically safe and cannot cause a spark. So the obvious benefit to a grain handler is certainly safer grain operations. Additionally, because it's intrinsically safe, and if the operators are properly trained, your plant general labor can maintain the system and change sensors. And that can lead to a great deal of savings over the life of the product instead of having to continually call a licensed electrician. So let's go into a little bit of the detail of the system itself and we'll bring some of these concepts home. So any hazard monitoring system needs a control or the brains. So we have two options that we promote. In the bottom right is our WS2 HM module. This device is about the size of a small jewelry box, and it will reside inside of your PLC cabinet on a rail. Now, conversely, we have a standalone controller that's shown in the upper right. That's our Easy Sentinel 128. This device will talk to 128 sensors and 15 of your machines simultaneously. And these are employed if you don't have a plant control system. Now coming back to the WS2 HM in the bottom right here, this device simply plugs directly into your plant Ethernet network or your plant PLC system with a single Ethernet cable. Now to explain the rest of the network, we branch out of our either one of these controllers through a network, what we call a bus converter network. And that part of the network speaks RS-45 Modbus protocol. Now, each of these blue circles represents what we call a bus converter. Each one of these bus converters will support 32 field sensors. And each of these bus converters supports its own miniature network and allows 32 sensors to communicate directly to the plant control multiple times every second. And we can have 8 of these bus converters and 256 sensors coming down that single bus directly to our web server and then seamlessly to any plant PLC or SCADA system. Now, from our bus converters, these devices also act as an intrinsic safe barrier. These devices will not allow the higher voltage to go beyond that blue device, and again provides that intrinsic safety to our entire system, or what we call our field interconnect box network. Now on these two bucket elevators, you can see these white squares. I hope you can see my cursor here that I'm pointing to. These white squares represent our field interconnect boxes. Okay, now these field interconnect boxes have six open ports that will receive any one of, six CMC sensors. So it could be our speed sensors, our belt alignment sensors, bearing temp, any of our sensors can plug into any field box and be recognized on the network. And each of these field interconnect boxes then are interlinked with category 5 direct burial cable. So to bring a couple of points home, once again, the network starts with the control box connected to your plant SCADA system or PLC system. You have our bus converter network. Each bus converter will support 32 field devices. You can have 8 bus converters on one web server, and up to 256 sensors connected directly to your plant Ethernet network or your PLC with a single Ethernet connection. And then adding our field interconnect box network, then we can actually branch and tee out of each field interconnect box and continue to grow the system. One last point on the architecture and the benefit to you as an end user. It's fairly common that we get asked to do a simple hazard monitoring system on a limited budget for an individual that needs to get to the minimum OSHA standard before harvest, as a for instance, but they really want to add conveyors later and increase the amount of monitoring they're doing on additional machines. So because of our branch and T architecture in our field interconnect box network, all you need to do is add your conveyor and simply punch down or connect additional category 5 cabling from the preceding field interconnect box, and you can grow your network very inexpensively and rapidly. I'd like to take a couple moments to drive home a couple of points on our controllers. So this particular device is our Easy Sentinel 128. It's an HMI with a built-in PLC. So you have a 6-inch graphical screen that will show all of your belt conveyors, bucket elevators, trippers, what have you, in a 3D graphic. This device is used if you do not have a plant automation system, and it will talk to 15 machines and 128 sensors simultaneously multiple times per second. This device is also intended and capable of driving audible alarms at preset set points for high temps, shaft speed slowdown for vibration. It will also allow you to sequence and shut down your machines at preset thresholds as well. And a couple other features and benefits. This device also will allow you to log 2 years worth of alarm history and also sensor histories, and you can graph and trend all of that data at your fingertips, and you can actually obtain that information inside of its brain through the internet. Our next controller is our WS2HM. We spoke a little bit earlier here today. Once again, it's a small box that resides inside of your PLC cabinet. It will speak once again directly to any plant PLC or SCADA system through a single Ethernet cable, as opposed to having racks and rows of expensive IO modules at your PLC. It'll talk to those 256 sensors directly. Now, this system is not considered proprietary or a black box per se. It is a CMC designed and manufactured device, but it will speak an open protocol via Modbus TCP IP or Ethernet IP protocol directly to your PLC. And once again, it speaks to those 256 sensors multiple times per second for very rapid control and rapid response to potential hazards. Just briefly, any and all of CMC's controllers have the ability to have easy to use 3D operator graphics. So before you, this is obviously a simple 3D image of a bucket elevator. And we mention this because what we want and what we have a philosophy at CMC is we want the ability to alert plant operations if there's a hazard. And we also want the ability for that operator to identify those hazards within a couple of seconds, to identify the location of the hazard and the nature of the hazard. We are showing real-time information on your bearing temperatures, your belt alignment, shaft speed sensing, and you can actually drill into each sensor and obtain your sensor histories and graphs. So next, we'll talk a little bit about the CMC sensors. Every CMC sensor comes with a quick disconnect, an industrial RJ11 connection, because we want the installations to be very fast and easy. So as compared to other traditional systems like RTDs and thermocouples, those sensors come with all these loose wires that have to be landed on terminal strips and screwed down, or wire tied and taped with black electrical tape. All of that takes an enormous amount of time. Additionally, CMC sensors are all digital. They have a digital IC chip in the nose of them, and they come from our factory pre-calibrated. They never have to be recalibrated. They never drift. Unlike other systems, traditional systems, they must be calibrated periodically to make sure that you are reading the proper information and that you are properly protected. Additionally, I want to talk about the sensors being smart sensors, in a sense. What they do and what they're able to do is actually continually send not only temperature or speed information to the plant control, but we are also providing what is called status. So they're constantly reaching out several times a second to the controller saying, I'm here, I'm alive. And why that's important is that there's so many systems out there that they're installed, but you don't know if they're necessarily operating properly. So really providing a false sense of security. So if one of our sensors becomes damaged, gets unplugged, or it just dies, it goes offline and it loses its status to the mothership, and you immediately get an alarm that says that particular sensor on that machine has gone offline. So that's an additional safety feature that we'd like you to consider. A little bit more detail about the sensors that are required under that NFPA 61 standard. And again, in reference to that particular bucket elevator, we'll start with bearing temperature monitoring. In the photo on the left here, you can see this stainless steel rod is a temperature probe. The stainless steel probe is inserted down into your bearing, and we are attempting to sense the temperature of the grease inside of that bearing. Hot grease inside the bearing is an indication that the bearing itself is beginning to heat up. So we want to be able to send that live data directly to your plant control and then alarm if that bearing starts to trend outside a predetermined threshold. Now, we also provide this brass mounting hardware, the fitting, and also the flexible conduit to protect the cabling and to keep mice and rats, and also to protect the cabling. So this device also allows you to grease through this ZERK portal directly to the bearing without having to disassemble all of this apparatus. The second in the series that is required is belt misalignment. For those that are new to the industry, your bucket elevator, the belt that's inside of there, or your belt conveyors that you have in your facility, if the belt happens to off track one way or the other, it can rub on the casing or on a frame member. And once again, that can cause a source of friction and a potential ignition. In the photograph on the left, we utilize what's called a rub block, and we thread a digital sensor into the back of that rub block so that in the event that belt rubs on this rub block, it'll hit that rub block before it hits the casing. And we will give the plant operations a notification that that belt is rubbing and that temperature is going up. And then you can choose to not only alert plant operations, but go into a controlled shutdown. In the photograph on the right, we are also now advising our clients to add misalignment detection of your head or tail pulleys. So this is the inside of a bucket elevator or belt conveyor, excuse me. And this brass rub block is placed in a location to detect if this belt pulley actually moves left or right, and it will come in contact with that brass block and provide you that alarm and that necessary shutdown. The next item on the list is quite possibly the most important, and that's shaft slowdown sensing. As we mentioned earlier, that a belt on a belt conveyor or a bucket elevator, if it's not tensioned properly, or if that belt expands or stretches, the driven or take-up pulley can begin to slip on that belt. And that can cause a source of a spark as well, or source of friction and a spark. So we are mandated, and you as owners are mandated to have the ability to detect if that belt slows down by 10%. And we give you then an audible alarm, and we advise that you actually shut the feed off to that machine. Because invariably, if that belt happens to slow down by 10%, it may slow down to 20%, and then you are mandated to go into a controlled shutdown. And hopefully you're shutting down a leg or a belt conveyor that is free of grain and product. The last device that is required in specific locations is the ability to sense if your downspouts become plugged. You can about imagine if a discharge spout after a leg or a belt conveyor in a classified environment, that grain plugging in the chute and backfilling into your conveyor can cause a heck of a mess and also damage your machinery and again, presents a potential hazard. Now, there's a number of different plug chute type of devices, but what we use and we prefer anyway is what's called a diaphragm switch. So on the inside of this assembly, on the inside of the chute itself, there is a round rubber diaphragm. So that as grain backs up into the chute, it'll come in contact with that diaphragm and it'll push a switch. And our hazard monitoring system will detect that and then take your system into a controlled shutdown. So next, we want to talk about the CMC field interconnect boxes versus traditional systems that use junction boxes. In the photograph on the left is the CMC field interconnect box. And I wanted to take a little time to explain how it works and some of the benefits. Across the top is a row of ports for our sensors to receive any CMC sensor. So these ports, there are six of them across the top, and our sensors come in the side, and the network category 5 comes in the bottom, and no cables come in the top, so we don't have water ingress. So this represents a significant time savings for the installers and maintenance people over the life of the product as compared to other traditional systems. In the photo on the right is a stereotypical junction box for an RTD system where you run several wires through your conduit and then you join them inside of a J-box or a junction box. And you take all these wire ties and electrical tape to join them. It's a bit of a mess and it takes quite a bit more time to maintain than the CMC system that once again has the quick plug sensors. So regardless of whatever system you have, how it is installed really matters. We've been blessed to have installed over 1,000 systems and over 400,000 sensors worldwide. And we have had occasion where an installer took some shortcuts, and it creates a great deal of pain for the end user and for CMC. So how it is it's installed really matters, and the types of cabling that you use for your system. So the CMC system, we recommend the use of a direct burial Cat 5 or Cat 6 cable. And the reason being is, one, it's gel filled along the entire length, so it makes it waterproof. And that it has an inner shield, copper shield, that helps for electrical noise immunity. Now, we've learned painfully over the years that water and electrical noise are the two biggest killers of any electrical system. So we go to great pains to reduce the risk of water ingress in our systems. And then additionally, direct burial category 5 cabling is used worldwide by telecommunications companies. So the supply of this cable is readily available, and it's very economical. I'm going to take a moment in a few slides to show some really good best practices. And this particular installer took great pains to do a good job for CMC and the end user client. And the picture on the left shows those blue bus converters we talked about. Again, these devices provide the intrinsic safety for everything downstream in our field interconnect box system and network. So these white boxes are field interconnect boxes. I failed to mention earlier, the field interconnect boxes and our bus converters are NEMA 4X. They're IP67 rated. So they are purpose-built and designed for some of the worst inside and outside environments. We do test them to minus 40 and above 100 degrees F. So again, they're purpose-built for very difficult environments. So a couple more best practices. I'd like to give a little shout out to one of our sister companies, Union Iron. These two pictures shows a CMC system on the side of a Union Iron bucket elevator. For those of you that are not familiar, Union Iron designs and builds world-class bucket elevators and chain conveyors and temp store ground pile storage systems. So I would certainly invite you to go visit their website when you get a chance. These photographs also, I wanted to show an excellent example of how to install a robust hazard monitoring system. You have, in the photo on the left, you have our field interconnect box mounted at a place that is accessible to plant operations. If they need to service the sensors, they can open these doors and test any sensor. You have your waterproof sensors coming in the side, and then your category 5 direct burial cable coming out of the bottom with nice drip loops, so no water can get inside of this box. This particular installer followed all the best practices. Couple other photographs that I thought we should show. This is a high roller enclosed belt conveyor at the tail section. You'll find the high roller conveyors in many types of applications across the world, be it a grain elevator, ship loading facility, processing facility, world-class leader in enclosed belt conveyors. Wanted to show just a couple of applications, and this particular installer also understands best practices. So you have your speed device for sensing if that belt were to, if that shaft slows down, if the belt isn't tensioned properly. You have your bearing sensor here, nice drip loops so no water can get in inside of this, inside the conduit. We have also a sensor here on the side. This flat sensor detects if the tail pulley off tracks. And then the field interconnect box and the bracketry supplied by CMC. One last picture. I thought this was an excellent picture taken by Mike. This is a picture of a series of high roller belt conveyors distributing grain to a row of bins. And you can see the CMC hazard monitoring system on the heads of these conveyors, another world-class application and installation. So allow me to touch on another subject that comes up invariably, and that's wireless technology that's emerging. And we get questions about this fairly regularly. And we're going to give you an opinion based out of 15 years of working with wireless radio and applications. So in our opinion, when we get asked this question, again, based on our experience, we recommend wireless only where wires are impractical. And that would be mobile trippers, moving ship loading conveyors, temps inside of grain bins. And in our opinion, that we do not recommend wireless radio applications for plant-wide hazard monitoring systems. There's just too much risk here involved. When it comes to radios, like your cell phones or the Wi-Fi in your office, when it comes to the lives of your people and protecting your people, there's too much risk for the loss of communications. There's potential for delayed communications. And when it comes to shaft speed detection, for instance, you have to have an immediate response to detect that belt is slowing. So we believe that there's just too much risk involved in wireless radio applications, and the minimal savings that you may get on a particular installation, to us, it's just too much risk involved, and that's an opinion. So I'd like to talk a little bit about HazMon in a box. This particular concept came about as a result of listening to our clients. Some years ago, when we did a survey, one of the complaints that came back about sensor companies, not just CMC, but other sensor companies as well, is that you send all these sensors to the field, and then I have to figure out how to mount them. I have to design and outsource bracketry. I have to get flexible conduit. I need to get junction boxes, etc. So we decided to create this concept called HazMon in a box. And that means we are supplying and pre-specifying all the sensors, all the bracketry, the mounting hardware, and all the pre-assembled field interconnect boxes that you need for that leg, for that drag, for that belt. Everything you need is in that box. So the benefit to you as an installer, as an owner or an automation firm, is that you have consistency from project to project and from site to site. They look the same, and you have standardized parts. And once again, by not having to reinvent the wheel on each project, it reduces the installation time. And we've actually proven it can reduce the cost of the installation as well. So this question comes up quite frequently. I have a HazMon system, Bob, and I have sensors. I'm fully protected, right? Well, I hope so. I hope that's the answer. But the first question I ask is, when was the last time you tested your system? And when was the last time you went out in the field and looked at it? Okay, so that is another, leads us to another service and concept that CMC offers. And that is site inspections. As part of our Roadmap to Safety program, we offer and strongly urge that whatever system that you have, that someone goes out and actually visually inspects the system and tests it, and that you have a documented process that is part of your preventative maintenance program. If you don't have one, you can call CMC. We do validation and testing on many of our customer systems, whether it's a CMC system or other systems provided on the market. Some of the other services inside of our Roadmap to Safety program is item one there is our site safety assessment and compliance audits. We spoke about this a little bit earlier, but this is once again a service we provide where we'll send a factory trained individual to your site, and we will catalog all your machines, and catalog all the safety devices you have or don't have, and then we'll give you a report and state you need to add these particular sensors to be compliant either to the OSHA or to the NFPA standard. And then lastly, as I stated before, we're very big on education, educating ourselves, our employees, and also people that use the CMC system. So we do have a certified installer program for all first-time installers of CMC systems. And we also are very adamant about training first-time end users and operators. Because if someone doesn't know how to use the system, they're going to be afraid of it and they may not use it properly. So once again, our drive is to become a partner with our customers and helping them to create and maintain a culture of safety in their organization. And some people, well, they'll look at safety as being a nuisance, but I'm here to tell you that we, together with other safety professionals, have proven that robust safety systems really leads to profits, and it's just good business. Real quick slide and a plug for the CMC Easy Tester. So the CMC Easy Tester is also part of our Roadmap to Safety program, and it's a device that we offer to our clients that is about the size of a cell phone. And you can use this safely in any part of your facility. And with this port on the top, you are able to walk up to any of our field interconnect boxes and test every sensor. You can also test any portion of the network for issues. So if you have a loose wire or if you have a short, you can detect that quite easily with the use of this tester. Additionally, you are able to emulate sensors. So during the validation process, we can't emphasize this enough, regardless of whatever system you have, you need a means to make sure that those sensors and any one sensor, you can identify it in the field and identify it on the user interface and that they match up. It's reading in the right place. And then more importantly, you need to be able to confirm that is your system going to shut you down if you have a shaft that's slowing down or a bearing that's getting hot. So this device allows you to test your plant interlocking and making certain your hazard monitoring system, your CMC hazard monitoring system, is operating as designed. So we're getting close to the end here, but I wanted to put one slide up here as an example. Now, this particular photograph was taken at a recent audit we did. And this particular device is a belt alignment switch. So this round puck is on the inboard side of the bucket elevator or belt conveyor. And you have to take off 4 bolts and then visually inspect this device. Now, what has occurred at this facility on 12 different sensors is that the grain dust has gummed up the perimeter and it does not allow this electromechanical device to compress, and it was rendered inoperable. And the scary thing is that plant operations has no idea that this device is dead. So I only bring this up to emphasize that regardless of the design or the type of system you have, they need to be inspected and tested. So lastly, my last slide, people ask, so what is stopping us as an industry in getting better? Well, you know, this isn't all about negative. Again, as I stated earlier, there's just dozens and dozens of dedicated safety professionals out there that I call friends. But we believe that the industry can do better. So really, to do better, what's stopping us is some locations and companies have ineffective and non-existent safety policies, sadly. Some organizations have lack of accountability from the leadership all the way down through plant operations. Another that's stopping us is low system dependability. We've seen many occasions where we tour a site and they have a hazard monitoring system and the operators say, well, that noisy thing on the wall, we just ignore it and we bypass it. And then in the event that there's a true hazard, they are not protected. And then lastly, Some organizations just lack the necessary documentation and validation procedures that are necessary to keep these systems in tip-top shape. So, folks, we are at the Q&A section, and through this presentation, we've been receiving questions, and we'll do our best to answer all your questions. If for some reason we go beyond our 60 minutes, we will take down every question and email a response yet today. You are also invited to please reach out to us. You can call me directly or call anyone at CMC or AGI. We'd be very interested to continue this dialogue. If you want to see a CMC representative to do a HazMon audit or an assessment, we'd be glad to help you out. So a few questions have come in. So let me just start with a couple that came in. My colleague handed me here. Let's start with this one. With all the safety devices monitoring my equipment, do I still need to climb up and physically inspect my equipment? Excellent question. So I'd like to ask my colleague, Rick McClellan, if you're still with us, could you hop on and share some of your experiences with us?
Sure. The CMC sensors are a good tool to use to help monitor, you know, the condition of the equipment, but nothing replaces visual inspection, hands-on, you know, exposure to the equipment, and following the guidelines put forth by your equipment manufacturer.
Well said, Rick, and you've been at this over 30 years. You've been to a few sites, so I'm sure you've seen many, many challenges. Good answer.
Yeah.
I'm going to keep rolling with some questions here. What devices and how many do you recommend for hazard monitoring on a standard high-life belt conveyor? I think that'd be a good one for Mike Spillum. Mike, you still with us?
Yep. So for years, at a minimum, we've always said we like to see a motion sensor to detect any belt slippage on the tail pulley, something you covered earlier, and a plug sensor if the following piece of equipment should back up or shut down. The plug switch will shut down our conveyor, which is designed to return spilled product. So if the following conveyor shuts down and ours doesn't, it's going to pull material back underneath the plug. So at a minimum, motion sensor and plug switch. But any more today, most of our customers are also installing the rub lock sensors for belt misalignment. And then, as you mentioned, the bearing temperature sensors are going to alert you to any bearing problems.
Well said. Thanks, Mike. Here's another one. What typically causes a belt conveyor, causes a belt on an elevator leg to slow down, and why is monitoring this so important? Rick, you still with us?
I am. I mean, there's a couple of things that can cause that. Inadequate belt tension, a plug shoot scenario, just the poor lagging on the head pulley. There are many things that can be a cause of that, but it is imperative that you monitor that and know what's going on, because if the head pulley loses traction with the belt itself, then it will slip and eventually burn the belt into, can ignite a fire or a dust explosion.
Well said. We've got a few others here and we still have some time, so I'm going to keep going down the list here. Can the high roller conveyor ship from the factory ready to receive and mount CMC sensors and devices? Another high roller question, Mike.
Sure. That's been pretty much standard procedure for a number of years now. We prefer to cut the holes in so that we are getting them located in the proper positions. On the head discharge end of the conveyor, we will mount them so they're not only monitoring the belt misalignment, but should a head pulley or a snub pulley slide over, we're picking up both of them. On the tail end, we've got cutouts for rub blocks, but also surface mount sensors should the reloading flippers rub against any casing. So yeah, we definitely like to cut the holes and provide shims. But then for older conveyors that are out there, you know, dating back 20, 30 years where the sensing devices weren't so prevalent, you know, people are going in today now and, you know, mounting rub blocks and whatnot. And even then, we prefer you call a factory because the way we mount or recommend the mounting of those are a little different than what we're doing today. Today, we're building the equipment to accommodate the sensors, whereas with some of your older equipment, we're adapting the sensors to equipment that was manufactured a little differently. So highly suggest that you call, you know, CMC or get Hyroler involved as you're retrofitting much older equipment also.
Well said, Mike. Thank you. Appreciate that. Let's take a look at the time here. It looks like we have time for some more questions. So, all righty. We have a question out there. Are your bus converters installed in hazardous areas? And if so, what classes and divisions? The bus converters, again, those are those blue boxes. Those are explosion proof. They're also NEMA 4X for indoor and outdoor uses. And yes, they are suitable for class one gases and class two dusts. So if you want to read the standard any further, we can provide the documentation that shows that device in our system has been tested and approved by Factory Mutual and ATEX rated. So very good question. Thank you. Well, we have time for a few more here. I have a couple of remote seasonal facilities that are typically manned by temporary employees. Are these hazard monitoring systems complicated to operate? No, they're not complicated to operate. So as I mentioned earlier, we are very big on education for all stakeholders in the process. So again, from first-time installers in our certification program, but we also have classroom and online web training for first-time users. So the CMC operator interfaces, for instance, have those simple 3D graphics we talked about to easily scan through to each machine you have and to look at all your sensors and all your live data. And once again, if there's an alarm at your facility, our philosophy has been, any of our controllers need to identify and allow an operator to identify exactly where that hazard is on your machine and which machine, and then also the nature of that hazard. So very easy to operate. Very good question, by the way. Well, we have a few more here. And once again, when we get to our 60 minutes, we will have, unfortunately, a hard cutoff, but we will email back all the answers yet today. And we certainly invite you and welcome any questions via email or through the internet or give us a call. Another question. Let's see. What if there is a power failure at my site? Do I need an electrician to bring the hazard monitoring system back online? The answer is no. The systems, firstly, are fail-safe. If you lose power, the CMC system will take you into an automated shutdown. That's fail-safe, and that's common, just common sense. But once that power comes back on, there's just an easy reset button on any CMC operator interface, and you'll be back up and running. Once your machine starts, the way we wire these together with your plant interlocks, once your machine starts, the CMC system starts automatically. So you are always protected. Excellent question. I see we have time for one more. Is there someone available to visit my site, my location, to help me identify what's best for my facility? Well, once again, as part of our Roadmap to Safety program, we do have factory trained technicians and other individuals that are capable of assessing your machines and your areas. And we can give you a recommendation on what types of prevention hazard monitoring systems and devices you need and where. We also have, again, factory trained technicians that can also help maintain your systems. So yes, give us a call. We'd really like to help you out. Well, folks, we are at 60 minutes and I didn't get to all your questions, but once again, we will email everyone present an answer, and we will have contact information if you'd like to continue the dialogue with CMC or someone at AGI. So, well, we all missed Jeeps this year, unfortunately, and we're looking forward to seeing you all next year. As soon as we are safely able to travel, give us a call. We'd love to come to your facility. And again, it's been my pleasure being your guest host here today. Everyone, please stay safe, and hopefully we'll see you at the next Jeeps Exchange. Take care.